Now, the welcome address by Professor Manfred Novak, Global Campus Secretary General.
Distinguished guests, dear colleagues, students, to be graduates, families. As you know, Italy was the first country in Europe that was heavily struck by the COVID-19 pandemic. It was already in late February 2020 that we had to close our monastery, work from our home offices, cancel many events, and quickly switch to online teaching, meetings, and conferences. Similar drastic measures were adopted and implemented by our partners in relation to the other six masters of the Global Campus of Human Rights in Buenos Aires, in Yerevan, Sarajevo, Pretoria, Bangkok, and Beirut. It was only in mid-August 2020 that we could open our monastery again and gradually resume in-person activities. It was at that time that we took, after long discussions, the difficult and courageous decision to invite the students of the new cohort of IMA to come in person to Venice. I must confess that this was one of the most difficult decisions which I had to take together with my colleagues during these highly uncertain times. In retrospect, I'm very happy that we took this decision, and I remember very vividly when we welcomed the first students arriving at the monastery 1 year ago. Of course, we had to impose quite heavy restrictions on your daily life as students. We reduced the number of students to be admitted, divided you in groups as only half of you could be taught at the same time in the Antonio Papisco Hall due to physical distances requirements, while the others had to follow lectures via live stream in other rooms of the monastery or from home. You had to quarantine, undergo regular testing and temperature controls, wear masks, go in shifts to the canteen, keep distance, and comply with many other COVID-19 related health requirements. Unfortunately, we also had to first postpone our Kosovo field trip in January and finally even cancel it this September, as Italian law does not yet allow any type of organized excursions. This was another very, very difficult decision which we were forced to take, and I felt very sorry for you, as this field trip is usually one of the highlights of the IMA program. During the second semester, when you were distributed to our network of European universities, you again had to comply with the respective rules of your host countries, follow classes online, and sometimes even had to communicate with your supervisor online. I'm extremely grateful to all of our staff at the Global Campus headquarters who did their utmost to enable and assist your studies under these extreme circumstances. Above all, the IMA team, the e-learning, IT, logistics, monastery management, and other departments. In particular, I would like to thank Wiebke Lama, outgoing IMA program director, for her tireless efforts and excellent organizational skills, as well as Orla Nijalajen, the new IMA program director, who is taking up her job in extremely challenging times and is doing so outstandingly. I'm equally grateful to the IMA professors who either came to Venice to teach or provide online courses and who received our students during the second semester and took care of their learning needs and supervision. But I'm most grateful to you, dear students and graduates of the 2020-21 IMA generation, for having mastered all these challenges with a lot of patience, dedication, and energy, for having fulfilled the academic requirements, and for having written excellent and innovative master theses under these truly exceptional circumstances. To a certain extent, the physical distancing requirements even created stronger feelings of togetherness and solidarity among yourselves, particularly during the cold and gray winter days at the Lido. I have many fond memories of social gatherings with you in our cloister and the few bars and restaurants that kept open during the winter months under COVID-19 restrictions. I also vividly remember our joint classes on human rights work in the field in January, when we were all sitting with warm coats in class as we had to keep the windows open. You are a truly remarkable group of graduates. We are proud of you, and we will always remember the 2020-21 class as the most resilient of our graduates and change makers. And you will need these strengths and resilience when you start your career as human rights professionals, as we are living in difficult times of enormous global crises and challenges, above all the global environmental and climate crisis. We are regularly told that human rights are in crisis. The more I hear this statement, the more I tend to disagree. Human rights continue to be the only universally accepted value system of our times. They provide long-term aims and objectives for a better, more peaceful, more prosperous, and more dignified world order. However, human rights are not only values, aims, and objectives. The international legal and political human rights framework also provides us with the tools and skills for solving conflicts and managing crisis situations. If we analyze new threats and challenges, such as, for instance, the COVID-19 pandemic, and the root causes through a human rights lens, we are much better equipped to find solutions and to apply effective risk management strategies. So not human rights are in crisis, but the current economic, social, and political world order finds itself in the worst crisis since the end of World War II. We need human rights, skills, and strategies more than ever to show us the way how to master this crisis. The recent events in Afghanistan provide the most dramatic example of this crisis of global governance. The international community withdrew under chaotic circumstances and left those Afghan women, men, and children behind who had trusted the international community to assist them in their efforts to end decades of armed conflicts and to build a more peaceful, prosperous, and democratic society. Those Afghans who had mostly and most closely cooperated with the international community are now most exposed to the repressive and inhuman rule of the Taliban. The Global Campus of Human Rights, together with many other organizations, appealed to the European Union and its member states to provide visa and to evacuate Afghan refugees at risk, and I'm glad that we could make a small contribution to help Afghan families to leave their country under these chaotic circumstances. I'm grateful to many universities in our global network who are willing to provide a safe space to Afghan scholars and students at risk, and I thank the European Commission for providing us with funds to cover the living costs of these refugees and their families. However, at the same time, I'm aware that many more Afghan families whom we could put on lists for evacuation flights were not able to reach the airport in Kabul and are still hiding. It also saddens me that Shahrazad Akbar, the president of the Afghan Independent Human Rights Commission, cannot be with us today in Venice. We invited her to the graduation ceremony to share her experience and thoughts with you. But despite support from Brussels, she could not get a visa and is currently still stuck in Turkey. The tragedy that is currently happening in Afghanistan strongly resonates with the social responsibility we feel as the Global Campus, as a network of 100 universities to support scholars and students at risk. In fact, we have been confronted with such cases for many years, be it in Myanmar, in Belarus, Egypt, just to name a few. While it unfortunately took the crisis in Afghanistan to create enough awareness and concern, we hope to strengthen our support to threatened scholars and students also outside the Afghan context in the years to come. This project aligns strongly with our recently adopted vision for the Global Campus to foster new generations of human rights defenders able to contribute to a world in which human dignity, equality, freedom, human security, sustainable development, democracy, the rule of law, and respect for all human rights are realized. We hope to take this vision one step further in the years to come to think about how we can prepare the Global Campus to be able to respond to the human rights challenges of the coming years. This also means strengthening human rights education capacities in democracies in need or under pressure, modeled on our successful project in Timor-Leste, where we helped to build up a human rights center at the National University in Dili. It also means empowering young human rights defenders, which we could do by setting up a bachelor's program on human rights and democracy, with which we hope to target in particular students who are displaced, exiled, or stateless. This is how we can support young change makers in their human rights activism and within their social movements. We are extremely grateful to have a very close and supporting partner in the European Union, which is why I'm very happy to welcome two good Irish friends of the Global Campus to Venice today, Eamon Gilmer, the EU's Special Representative for Human Rights, and Michael O'Flaherty, Director of the European Union Fundamental Rights Agency in Vienna. In the context of our excellent partnership with Right Livelihood towards the protection and promotion of children's rights, we are delighted to welcome the Ethiopian human rights lawyer, Yetneberg Negusi Moller, who received the Right Livelihood Award in 2017 for her inspiring work promoting the rights and inclusion of people with disabilities. Thank you all for being with us and sharing your thoughts and reflections with the students and guests shortly. Before coming to an end, I would also like to take a moment to welcome the new cohort for EMA students who arrived in Venice only last week. We're extremely happy to have you with us in person in Venice, though you are now only following this ceremony via the live stream. We very much hope that this academic year will be less challenging and restrictive than the last, and look forward to eventful months with you. Dear graduates of the 2020-21 cohort of the European Master in Human Rights and Democratization, I most warmly congratulate you once again to your outstanding achievements and welcome you in our growing network of EMA and Global Campus educated human rights defenders and change makers. You will start working in interesting and extraordinary times, full of challenges, but also opportunities. We are proud of you and I wish you to ensure you that you can always count on our support in the future and on the support of the EMA alumni network. Thank you for your attention.
And now, the Chancellor of the Scuola Grande of San Rocco, Alfredo Baroncini.
I will translate Mr. Baroncini.
Buonasera. Sono Alfredo Baroncini, cancelliere di questa scuola grande, e porgo a voi tutti il saluto del guardian grande, purtroppo assente perché fuori da Venezia, della cancelleria e dei confratelli tutti. Siamo ben lieti di ospitare in questo antico e mirabile sito eminenti rettori e professori, autorità dell'Unione Europea, dell'Italia, del Veneto e di Venezia, i premiati e gli studenti di questo importante master in diritti umani.
I'm Mr. Alfredo Baroncini. I'm representing here the Scuola Grande of San Rocco, and I bring my greetings from the whole Scuola Grande, the Chancellorship, the Guardian Grando, and all the confriars. We are very happy to host you here and host distinguished professors and students to the Scuola Grande.
Per molti non del luogo, ritengo opportuno chiarire che per gli antichi veneziani la parola scuola aveva un significato diverso dall'attuale.
For many of you, probably the name scuola had in the ancient Venetian times a different meaning than what it is now.
Essi infatti erano usi raccogliersi in circa un centinaio di pie confraternite chiamate appunto scuole, enti laici e privati che avevano come fine principale la carità e l'assistenza.
The schools were in fact almost 100, smaller and bigger, and they were secular organizations that used to organize services for the communities, charity, food, provide shelter to many in the poorest areas of society.
Tutte curavano il loro prestigio. Si può affermare che per secoli esse abbiano gareggiato per disporre di fabbricati più belli e decorati dagli artisti migliori. Pensate, questo fabbricato è costato 47.000 ducati d'oro del 1500.
So all the schools were competing with the time to have the best locations in Venice and also to have the best prestige, to be very prestigious in the local community. This school costed at the time 47,000 golden ducati.
E la scuola di San Rocco, delle centinaia che abbiamo visto, fu l'unica che salvò il suo stato giuridico e il proprio patrimonio artistico dalle soppressioni, confische e saccheggi francesi del 1797 e 1806.
The school that you see was one of the few that managed also to survive the confiscation and robberies that happened with the French occupation of Italy at the end of the 18th century.
Jacopo Robusti, detto Tintoretto, in 24 anni realizzò una settantina di grandi dipinti con episodi dell'Antico e Nuovo Testamento e della vita di San Rocco.
Jacopo Robusti, the Tintoretto, realized here more than 70 paintings that depict the life of San Rocco.
Chiesa e scuola di San Rocco posseggono inoltre opere di altri grandi artisti, quali Giorgione, Tiziano, Tiepolo, Pordenone, Solimena e Strozzi, e così via, oltre a notevoli raccolte di oreficeria, argenteria, ceramica, tappeti e paramenti sacri.
The school, in addition, hosts several work of arts of very many important artists, including Tiziano, Giorgione, Solimena, and many others, and in addition also silverware and goldware and religious antiques.
La scuola di San Rocco conserva tuttora il suo primitivo assetto istituzionale di ente laico e privato.
The school still conserves its original legal status as a secular and private institution.
È regolata da uno statuto approvato nel 1913 dal re Vittorio Emanuele III e dal capo del governo Giovanni Giolitti.
Its statute was set up in 1913 with the king Vittorio Emanuele II and with Giolitti as head of government.
I confratelli ora sono circa 500, che devono essere veneziani per nascita o residenza stabile.
The confriars are up to now 500 and that have to be either Venetian born or resident in Venice.
Si riuniscono due volte all'anno in assemblea, eleggono il presidente, che è il guardian grande, e gli altri membri della cancelleria, che costituisce il consiglio di amministrazione.
So they meet twice a year and they elect their guardian grande, their president, and their board.
Tutte le cariche che durano un triennio sono rinnovabili e non sono in alcun modo retribuite.
Everybody is working for free for the confraternita.
Basta, vi ringrazio per l'attenzione e vi auguro buon lavoro.
Thank you for the attention and good work to everybody.
And now for the municipality of Venice, Mr. Emanuele Moreso, city council member.
Può togliere la mascherina.
Buonasera a tutti. Prima di tutto vi porto i saluti del sindaco della città di Venezia che non ha potuto oggi essere qui.
Thank you all. First of all, I would like to bring you the greetings of the mayor of Venice, Mr. Brugnaro, who unfortunately cannot be here with us today.
Volevo oggi principalmente ringraziare. Prima di tutto volevo ringraziare tutto il personale, sia quello organizzativo, sia il personale docente del Global Campus of Human Rights.
First of all, I would like to provide my thanks to all of you, and starting from the organizational staff and all the teaching staff of the Global Campus.
Che anche in un anno così difficile, segnato dal dover organizzare con tutti i limiti imposti dalla pandemia, è riuscito comunque a portare avanti questo corso all'interno della nostra città, che noi ci fregiamo sia fatto proprio qui.
I'm thank them for being so resilient to organize even in such a difficult times with COVID the course with all the students and professors, and we are very proud of you for doing so.
Volevo poi ringraziare la Scuola Grande di San Rocco, che vi permette di fare questo evento in una cornice veramente unica al mondo. Credo che se vi guardiate intorno, pochi potranno dire di aver ricevuto dei diplomi in una sede bella come questa.
I would also like to thank Scuola Grande di San Rocco for hosting this very important event. I think not a few may say that they've had a graduation ceremony in such a beautiful building.
Volevo poi ringraziare e me ne vorrà l'organizzazione dedicare due parole a quelli che sono i grandi protagonisti, cioè i ragazzi che hanno partecipato a questo master.
I would like then to give two words to the real protagonists of today, so the students.
E volevo ringraziarli per la sfida che hanno deciso di raccogliere, quella di studiare i diritti umani per poi lavorare appunto in questo difficile campo.
Thank you for taking up the challenge of working in such a difficult field as human rights protection.
Una sfida fondamentale, soprattutto oggi, in un momento storico dove la pandemia, da un lato, ha messo a nudo tutti i problemi riguardanti i diritti umani radicati nel nostro sistema, dai cambiamenti climatici alla disparità tra paesi, alla violazione in molti paesi delle libertà fondamentali, che anche se non è legato alla pandemia, viviamo in questi giorni direttamente con la difficile situazione dell'Afghanistan.
We notice this the more so because in a situation of pandemics all the human rights underlying crisis and Afghanistan of course is to be mentioned first in this moment have become even more evident and urgent to everybody.
Dall'altro però proprio l'evento pandemico ci costringe a ripensare il mondo di domani. E proprio in questa ripensare il mondo dobbiamo mettere la centralità dei diritti umani, ricordandoci che in quanto tali non possono essere legati a una particolare condizione o a un particolare contesto che consenta di cautelarli, legandoli magari a un luogo o a un periodo, ma devono essere diritti che valgano per tutti, sempre e in ogni luogo, perché legati appunto al nostro essere persone, non al dove ci troviamo. E questa sfida centrale è quindi quella di trovare un modo di fondare questi diritti che ci permetta di difenderli ovunque.
The pandemic also helps us to remember that human rights are central to all our endeavors. They are the paradigm upon which we should build our work. And they are not dependent on the location, on the country, on the context in which they have to be applied. They are inherent to every human being.
In questo pensare al futuro hanno un ruolo centrale le città, come anche mostra la mostra che stiamo ospitando per la Biennale Architettura, in cui ci invita a ripensare le città di domani. E qui non posso sicuramente esentarmi da porvi l'esempio proprio di Venezia, la città che in questo anno vi ha ospitati.
Central to this work are cities, as also it's emerging if you have had the chance to see the architecture biennale. So cities have a big role in terms of human rights protection.
In questo anno di celebrazione del 1600esimo dalla fondazione di Venezia, l'abbiamo definita la più antica città del futuro. Una città dove l'unione di natura e cultura, che richiamandosi a vicenda e rispettandosi, ha portato ad un monumento di bellezza inestimabile, amato e apprezzato in tutto il mondo.
This is very true also of the celebration that we have this year in Venice of the 1600 years since the foundation of the city, that we call now Venice the nicest city, oldest city of the future.
Una città in cui la libertà di pensiero e la libertà di culto è sempre stata centrale. Basti pensare alle scuole, appunto, che confrontavano il loro pensiero, e al fatto che è una città dove da sempre sono state presenti tutte le religioni e tutte le confessioni cristiane che ancora sono presenti anche oggi.
This is a city where freedom of belief and religion have always had a big space, and all the communities and religious communities have always been hosted and welcome.
Una città poi, come veniva ricordato appunto prima sulle scuole, dove l'attenzione verso i più deboli era sempre centrale, dove c'era sempre un modo per cercare di aiutare chi era in difficoltà.
And also a city where all the people that are vulnerable, poor, have always had a central attention and role.
Quindi oggi voi raggiungete questo importante traguardo. Io vi auguro sia solo il primo passo in questo movimento verso la crescita dei diritti umani, e spero che anche un domani potremo festeggiare altri grandi risultati, magari proprio in questa bellissima città. Grazie.
I thus welcome your work, and I'm sure that this is one of the first of your goals, so you will continue to attain more achievement in human rights protection for the future. Thank you. And now the keynote speeches by Mr. Eamon Gilmour, EU Special Representative for Human Rights.
Thank you very much, Global Campus President Veronica Gomez, Secretary General Manfred Novak, Member of the European Parliament Gianfranco Dell'Alba, distinguished guests and fellow speakers. Let me first of all thank my fellow speakers, Michael O'Flaherty and Yetnebersh Ngozi Mollya, for agreeing to allow me to skip the queue and to speak first, because I have to get an early flight to get back to Brussels. I want to join all of you in, first of all, welcoming the new students who started this week, and of course to congratulate the graduates today. This is a day for celebration, for joy, for some relief perhaps. It's a day to be shared with those who are closest to you, parents, partners, family, friends, and of course with the wonderful professors, teachers, tutors and staff of the Global Campus who have helped you to get here today. Graduation day is always a day of triumph, but especially so, I think, for those of you who are graduating today, because you have had to overcome adversities unknown to those who have gone before you. The global pandemic has, as Manfred said earlier, had a big impact on your studies and on your experience of university life. But also, of course, it has had enormous impact on human rights throughout the world. And I think today of those all over the world who have lost their lives in this pandemic. We think of the disproportionate impact that the pandemic has had on the most vulnerable. We think of consequences such as the rise in domestic violence, and indeed the abuse of emergency powers in some country to consolidate the power of autocrats. But it has not been the only challenge that we have faced in recent times. I think too of the violence that is continuing in Ethiopia, the military coup that occurred in Myanmar earlier this year, the brutal suppression of peaceful protest and those who want nothing but democracy in Belarus, and the 700 almost political prisoners who are languishing in jail as we speak today. And of course, at an educational event like this, who cannot but think of what is happening in Afghanistan? Girls over 12 told they cannot continue their education. Women in universities told they cannot attend the same classes as their male colleagues, and a place where events like this would not be possible. And that is why I am so pleased, Manfred, to hear you say here today that the Global Campus with your universities are working on a program to enable Afghan scholars and students to join in the work and effort of the Global Campus, and to be able to say to you, as you have acknowledged, that the European Union will support that effort, and I know that you are finalising the details with the Commission. You are graduating at a time when we are truly, I believe, fighting a global battle on human rights and democracy, defending its universality and indivisibility. And as with any crisis, we must face into it. And certainly that is the approach that the European Union is taking. The adoption last November of our new action plan on human rights and democracy, which includes ways in which we can address the new challenges of human rights on technology, on business, and of course on climate change. The adoption last December of the new European Union global human rights sanctions regime. The increased provision in the European Union budget and the European Instrument for Democracy and Human Rights, the largest of its kind in the world, to promote human rights and democracy in the world, which includes, of course, the support that the European Union provides for human rights education, and in particular the support that we provide for the Global Campus. The European Union started to support the Global Campus, a unique project in human rights education, as far back as 1987, almost a quarter of a century ago, and we continue to do that. It is a great investment by the European Union, because we now have more than 4,200 alumni of this university working on human rights in governments, in international organisations and institutions, and in NGOs and in campaigns and on the ground all over the world. And those of you who are graduating here today will now be joining all of these alumni and this network. Those who learn together will work together, and we need that collaborative work in the time ahead. As I said, it is a time of great challenge, but I think the message that I want to leave with you today is that we must face that challenge with confidence and with determination, because the world cannot afford to lose the universal values of human rights and democracy. This is a struggle that we dare not lose in the interests of all of humanity. But it is a struggle that we have to work on together, and it is one that we have to approach with a great degree of confidence. There's a great Irish poet, Seamus Heaney, in one of the darkest times of the history of my own country, wrote about that tidal wave of injustice, and wrote about how a longed-for tidal wave could rise up, and that hope and history could rhyme. But it is a later stanza of that particular poem that I think perhaps captures this moment even better, and it is this. So hope for a great sea change on the far side of revenge. Believe that a further shore is reachable from here. believe in miracles and cures and healing wells. Thank you very much and good luck with everything you do.
And now the keynote of Mrs. Jetneberg Ngusi Mola, disability rights activist and Right Livelihood Laureate 2017.
Dear President of the Global Campus, Secretary General, Member of the Parliament, distinguished speakers, above all, distinguished graduates and families, invited guests. It's indeed a great pleasure and honor for me to stand in front of you, to share with you this special day of your life, which our EU Special Representative, Mr. Gilmore, mentioned that it is indeed a triumph. I want to start by sharing and repeating the word, congratulations. It's a big day for you, but a big day for those of us who fight for human rights all over the world, and in particular, my fellow laureates in the Rights Livelihood family, that we get an additional army of human rights who can stand with us, not only with confidence, but also with competence to protect the most needed value of life, human rights. And it's not about adding value for somebody else. It's just as minimum as allowing someone born with rights to die with the rights that he or she has come with. It's not about importing it. It's about protecting it. It's about promoting it. Today, we heard two countries being repeatedly mentioned: Ethiopia, my own country, and Afghanistan, another point of focus. I think it's a critical point in time that you are graduating, where the gains that the human rights community has made so far are being questioned and being threatened again. Girls who were able to go to school are sent back again. Persons with disabilities, whom we have been crying about being deinstitutionalized, have passed away because of COVID-19 without being seen by their loved ones. These are the rights you're supposed to defend. These are the people, these are the voices who are going to claim you become their voices. It's not easy, and the red carpet, to become a human rights professional, as has been explained before. In particular now, where COVID-19 has shown us, in such crisis times, those who were already marginalized become re-marginalized. Those who were excluded becomes re-excluded. So resilience, as Manfred was highlighting, is critically important. And we build on communities which can stand together with the principles of universality, indivisibility, and inalienability. When I studied law in Addis Ababa University, I was thinking that everything could be fixed with courts and that we can get rule of law by the justice machinery. But I believe we don't have enough prisons to imprison everybody violating rights in the airport, in the hotels, in the hospitals, and every places. The best way to get human rights promoted and protected is by educating. So I would like to congratulate your professors who have been producing a fantastic and very highly needed army of human rights That will definitely change our world. The more we educate people, the more we empower them, then the more we disarm those who are fabricating weapons to fight, kill each other, harm and threaten climate, as well as the well-being of humanity. Allow me to share with you that the Fellow Laureates in Rights Livelihood, which I am representing today in a very successful partnership with the Global Campus of Human Rights, are not human rights graduates. We are people of desire of all human rights for all the people in all the times and all the places are protected. And I should be honest to confess to you, there was no single continent where our laureates did not face challenge when they fight for the promotion and protection of human rights. Everywhere, including in a place where we call that they are mothers of democracy and human rights, democracy and human rights are not fully implemented, regardless of the good news that we hear. What is important is that the universality and indivisibility applies to our daily life, where human rights is threatened somewhere, becomes a threat everywhere. It's a reality today, as Martin Luther King was telling us years and decades back, that a human rights threat in Afghanistan affects someone in Germany, Italy, and back to Africa. COVID-19 has taught us that we are ever interconnected, not to be detached. We are ever interdependent on one another. So I would like to call on all of you today, as you mark your day of celebration, that we remove the barriers for those who are unable to exercise the rights that they were born with, and ensure that we commit our lives, sometimes including our families, in order to make sure that they die with their rights. Again, I would like to emphasize that you're starting a rough journey with your armed knowledge and skills that are needed everywhere to combat the stereotypes, prejudices, and myths about human rights. I'm sure your addition to this very demanding work at a time as human rights professionals will lead those dark days to which our human rights fellow laureates will be definitely celebrating. I know you have a tough road ahead, but I can tell that you were tested by COVID as gold would be tested by a fire. So today we see you shining, not shining to show yourselves, shining to show others and make them visible than ever, make their voices heard. Good luck, keep hands together, and make sure that the human rights work will definitely need your skills, confidence, and competence. And even though you're finalizing this master's as a European master's, I'm sure you're needed everywhere, including Africa, America, Australia, and Asia. I would like to call upon you that use your education to challenge norms and change the discourse of human rights being luxury. It's my need to be educated. It's a need and a right of a girl in Afghanistan to be educated. Let's stand together and make a closer move towards what they call the new normal. Let's build forward together and make human rights not a privilege, but a right for all. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Now, Mr. Michael O'Flaherty, Director of the EU Agency for Fundamental Rights.
How do I follow that? President, Secretary General, dear friends, let me at the outset, of course, offer my own warm and sincere congratulations to all of you who are graduating today. It's been an extraordinary year, but you know that you've lived through it. Well done to you and to all those who have supported you. And welcome to all the new students who are with us online. Now, as I was preparing for today, I thought back to why I ever did a human rights degree, what motivated me all those years ago. And in my case, it was two inspiring teachers who somehow convinced me and many others that human rights could make a dramatic change for the better in society. Now, there are as many reasons as people in this room as to why you chose to study human rights. But my guess is that at the essence, at the heart of your choice, was something just like mine. It was something about studying human rights and democratization in order to contribute towards making our societies that little bit fairer, that little bit more equal. Sometimes it's very challenging to keep the faith, if you will, in the ability of human rights to make these changes. Every speaker today has quite correctly spoken to the shocking situation around the world. You don't have to, by the way, go to Afghanistan or Ethiopia to see deeply disturbing patterns of neglect of and abuse of human rights. Here within the EU, too, we have much of which we cannot be proud. I think, for example, of the way populism, for a number of years now, has been eroding our systems and our structures, our rule of law. I think of the frankly shocking inequality in our European societies, a fact that has been made so visible in the context of COVID during the past year. I think, for instance, of a Roma child who last year was told to go home and distance learn, was asked to go home to unsuitable, barely adequate accommodation, where he or she was expected to use a computer that they did not own, with an internet access that they did not have. And their parents were expected to support that child, even though the parents were probably out of work. It was bad work to start with, but now it was gone. They didn't have access to social welfare, and every day it was a choice between food or clothing, just to survive. I think of the little Roma child that said to a colleague of mine, "I miss school, because school was the only place where I could dream." And so, yes, we face a deeply worrying pattern of human rights abuse and deprivation everywhere on this earth. And on top of that, we also see in academic circles increasingly loud voices dismissing human rights, suggesting that human rights is yesterday's agenda, yesterday's way to build better societies. There are better models now that we should follow. And so with all of this then, where do we look for our hope? Where do we look for the confidence to get us out of bed in the morning and do the human rights work we either are already committed to or are embarking on? Well, last year, a group of friends of mine came together virtually. There were 7 or 8 of us from all over the world, working in wildly differing settings and contexts, and in as many countries as there were individuals on the call. And we met about 10 times to figure out for ourselves where we would find the hope to keep on going. I'd like to share with you just a few of the learnings from our discussions last year. The first one, of course, was the obvious one: let's never forget how much has been achieved. I think Manfred spoke about it earlier this afternoon, this astonishing story since the end of the Second World War, how much we can be proud of at the national level, the regional and the global level in terms of the laws and the institutions. But we can also, those who've been working in human rights, we can search back in our own lives to see those moments where our work made a difference for human well-being. I, for example, was able to think back to how my colleagues and I gave evidence in international courts which led to the locking up of war criminals. That's a cause of some satisfaction. To take an entirely different context, I recalled how I worked with a group of other human rights academics and activists to map out the application of international human rights law for LGBTI people. And I recall how we got an email the day we launched these principles from somebody who said, "I am a trans person. Yesterday I didn't exist, but now reading these principles, I'm a human being." And these are just two memories I have from my life, but they can be replicated across the lives of everybody who has worked for the cause of human rights. We went from there, of course, to acknowledging that we have a lot we need to fix. We can do our work much better. Now, I could choose to give all sorts of examples this afternoon of where we figured that we, as a human rights community, could do a better job, but I don't want that to be my focus, because we went still further again in our reflections, and we set about exploring what is the spark, what's the essence, what's the fire in the belly of human rights, the thing that will really get us to jump out of bed in the morning, active and engaged. We threw many concepts around in our discussions. Ultimately, we settled on the idea of dignity. Dignity is a concept familiar to human rights. It's in Article 1 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, but honestly, it's neglected as the driver of our work. And we considered, and I consider now, that if we restore dignity to its proper place at the heart of what we do, we will transform our work in human rights activism of whatever form it might take. When we put dignity at the heart, for instance, we can no longer tolerate any hierarchies between people, hierarchies of the value of any human. The idea that any human or any group of humans is more deserving than any other becomes unthinkable. If we put dignity at the heart of our work, then we can never avoid the universality of human rights and the need for us to be ever committed to supporting and defending universality, but a very particular kind of universality. A universality that goes out of its way in delivering universally to reach out to the most vulnerable, the people at the very edges of our societies. Dignity also transforms some quality of the goals of human rights. By putting human dignity at the heart, we're not promoting through human rights societies where we tolerate each other. We're promoting societies where we rejoice in each other, in all of our astonishing diversity. And finally, just to take one more example of what happens when we put dignity at the heart, and that is that putting dignity there, we also recognize that we too have human rights responsibilities. Those responsibilities are not just of the state, they are of ourselves. There's a commitment person to person when we re-engage dignity. Again, an idea in the Universal Declaration, but often overlooked. Now, there's one last dimension of our reflections over the past year I want to share with you this afternoon, and it had to do with the spirit that animates us. Dignity is the core idea, but what's the spirit that must drive us? What's the attitude, the emotion, if you will, that we should capture for our work? Well, certainly it was clear to us what's not acceptable as our attitude. Apathy has no place. Passivity, business as usual, things of this nature. The issues before us are far too urgent. So what can we replace those with? Well, we considered anger. We tossed that around for a while. And then somebody suggested anger wasn't great because it would exhaust us. So we decided that anger wasn't the spirit to inform our work. But then we thought back to a book published in 2010 by the extraordinary public intellectual of France, Stéphane Hessel. He wrote a book in 2010 called Indignez-vous. It was a book about the need for us to wake up and save the human rights system that we had constructed so carefully since the Second World War. Indignez-vous, get indignant. And we thought, that's it. What we need is to do our human rights work with indignation. And what would that mean? Well, we went back to Stéphane Hessel's book. And for him and for us, it means that in our work, we must first wake up to what is at stake, and we've heard about it from the speakers this afternoon. Second, we must be aware of the need for urgent response. This isn't a slow-burning fire. It's an all-consuming one that's already upon us. Third, indignation means we must never turn away from injustice. And fourth, indignation means that we must be unapologetic in demanding respect for law. And so, my friends, then, my wish to you today is that as we all go forward together as human rights practitioners, that we be filled with indignation in a shared struggle to honor the dignity of everyone. Thank you.
And now interpreti veneziani will play for us Concerto per quattro violini, violoncello, archi, cembalo, opera 3 numero 10, estro armonico di Antonio Vivaldi.
Thank you.
And now the addresses are by the student representatives, Mrs. Naomi van der Broek and Mrs. Charles Leboeuf.
We have still 8 minutes left now. But 3 One tree and another tree, each standing alone and erect, and the wind and the air tell their distance apart.
But beneath the cover of earth, their roots reach out, and at depths that cannot be seen, the roots of the trees intertwine.
Cari ospiti, che piacere essere qui insieme.
Grazie mille, siamo molto felici di condividere questo momento con voi.
Dear distinguished guests, fellow students, Manfred, Orla, George, Chiara, Daniela, Imke, Sara, Stefania, Daniela again, Elisabetta, Elisa, Nicola, Luca, thank you for making this year possible and impossible to forget.
It is our pleasure to be here tonight with you in Venice, in the Salone Maggiore of the Scuola Grande di San Rocco, founded in 1478.
I hope I did say Wiebke, right? Because otherwise now I also say Wiebke, thank you. It feels appropriate to say what a year it has been. The first semester can be summarized by a few words.
Spritz.
Insightful.
Face masks.
We arrived on Lido with boats, even cars, such as Cindy, with excitement, sometimes two heavy bags, and big human rights aspirations.
We fell in love with the city and its colorful sunsets, and we fell from our bikes.
We ordered Pinto Pizza and an Italian love affair, and what we got was delivered a TS1 exam despair.
We wrote the essays and the thesis, letters to each other, our names in the sand on the Lido beach.
We filled in canteen menus, application formulas, wished each other happy birthdays, even those who actually didn't have their birthday.
We were looking for Zoom links, Christmas presents in the monastery, maybe sometimes spots to hide, and the cheapest wines.
We faced high water, public health restrictions, and printing problems.
We smiled when we saw the canteen staff, when Diego popped up champagne bottles, and when the 24-hour take-home exam was over.
Sitting here all together, our biggest worry was this morning how we should dress and if we would be able to walk these heels on these heels in Venice.
We seem to forget that only a few months ago we had other difficulties. Some of us arrived weeks later after being in quarantine. We had to stay focused in online lectures about investor agreements.
We had to align different opinions on how to deal with this pandemic. We were wondering if we would go home for Christmas and we would see our families again.
We had the disappointment of the Kosovo cancellation. We felt lost in the second semester, and some of us could not go at all to their second semester destination.
We sat at canteen tables with three people, and we were not allowed to talk. And we could go on, but let's be honest, let's get this EMA spirit alive.
What is this EMA spirit about? It is the Luisa party. It is the fancy reception of yesterday at the monastery without dancing.
We supported each other with a mental health support system. We attended Zoom lectures all together, sometimes from our bed.
We organized a football game, a karaoke, a Halloween candy hunt, a beach picnic, fun Vaporetto rides. We organized an amazing film festival, Zoom study sessions, and get-togethers in the second semester.
We had mulled wine and spent Christmas with our AME friends, who became our second family. We may not have been to Kosovo, but we found each other in Malomoko, the metropolitan hub of Lido.
We know that some of you, well, 99% to be correct, worry about what is next. But we advise you to be kind to yourselves. We did not choose the easy path, some coming from completely different study fields like medicine and physiotherapy. But once you found your way and a high-paid job, it will be even more rewarding. Believe in yourself and others will too.
And now I would like you to all do together a little meditation session as we often did after lunch and also in the second semester. So I invite you, all of you, to close your eyes for a second. And I would like you to think when you started a new chapter of your life, the excitement and maybe also the fear it gave you, the first time you came here in Venice, what you thought of the buildings, of the sea, maybe also the first time you saw your house in Lido, the flatmates. Maybe you were wondering if you would like them, maybe some other students that you would maybe never thought of actually appreciating who became your best friends, maybe now. How you felt when you said goodbye after this new chapter in the first semester. I would also like you to think about a difficult moment this year, as it was a very challenging year for every one of us. And maybe something that make you happy, some small gesture by someone maybe that you didn't even know, or like you discovered the beauty of nature again. And now I would like you to think like how happy we should be to be here together in this beautiful room. Clearly you did something great, right? So I would like you to open your eyes again and smile behind these masks and think we are so happy to share this moment together.
Yesterday, Therese Murphy told us to choose our words rightly. So I have a few important words for you. Each and every one of you are beautiful individuals and shine a beautiful light on this world. As Dumbledore said to Harry Potter, and as some of the best wisdom comes from children's books,
happiness can be found
even in the darkest of times.
If one only remembers to turn on the light.
Just as the trees in the poem by Haiqing, we now have roots in common at depths that cannot be seen. In the upcoming years, let's give water to these roots to keep them strong.
And what else can we say? See you later, alligator.
Emma, perché ti amo?
May the MA baby spirit be with you everywhere you go. I won't be afraid, not as long as you stand by me.
Thank you.
Now the awarding of diplomas to the European Masters in Human Rights and Democratization 2020-2021, introduced by Dr. Orla Nishelchan and IMA Program Director, together with the professors of the IMA universities. Professors are invited to come to the front of the podium to deliver the diploma. I will call the name of the university and professor, and Orla will call the students by name, and the IMA rectors and directors will hand out the diplomas together with the help also of Daniela, who is handing the diplomas to the professors. Thank you. Please, Orla. So for the University of Vienna, the IMA director, Professor Christina Binder.
Mataljuba Karamova. Gonçalo Rola Quierterio. Katia Stokes.
For the University of Graz, the IMA director, Professor Gert Oberleitner.
Oyandari Bamunik. Mariana Gonçalves Felger Ferrara. Elena Milas Villarubia.
In representation of Catholic University of Leuven, the IMA chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Katie Boatwright. Valeria Serboliska.
For Université Libre de Bruxelles,
the IMA director, Professor Julien Perret.
Fabio Calzati.
In representation of the University of Zagreb, the IMA chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Freya Smith.
And representing the University of Cyprus, the IMA chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Agnes Heinrici. Dolce Miranda Matos. Mafalda Moreira de Cunha y Carita Matias.
For the University of Southern Denmark and Danish Institute for Human Rights, the Delegate of Director, Professor Tim Jensen, and the IMA Director, Dr. Eva Maria Lassen.
Serena Alonso Garcia. Alessandra Cisi.
For the University of Tartu, the IMA Program Director, Professor Laura Malxo.
Maria Rosa Malinese.
Representation of Obo Academy University, the IMA chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Maria Carolina Martins de Bastos Correa y Souza.
For the University of Helsinki, in representation of the IMA Director, Professor Sebastian Machado Ramirez.
Sonia Dmitry Yevich in absentia.
That's good. Sorry.
No. Sorry.
For the Université de Strasbourg, in representation of the University, the IMA chairperson, Therese Murphy.
Doloretse Kajušajš. Petja Mitova.
And in your presentation, Seal of Université de Montpellier, the immature person, Professor Therese Murphy.
Dominic Lowers.
For Ruhr University Bochum, the IMA director, Professor Hans Joachim Heinze.
Flavia Galeazzi. Colleen Kane. Sophia Papadopoulos.
For the University of Hamburg, the IMA chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Rian Mikael Mangan. Mangan. Excuse me.
For Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, in representation of the IMA program director, Professor Anna Maria Consta.
Annelie Borien. Monica Zumela Kariugi Martinez. And Maria Rufine Carvajal de Silva in absentia.
For Pantheon University Athens, the IMA program director, Professor Maria Daniela Maruda.
Ellen Nguyen. Nicholas Leonard.
Representing National University of Ireland, Galway, the IMA chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Victoria Thornton.
For National University of Ireland, University College Dublin, the IMA program director, Graham Finlay.
Rita Denise Race.
Yeah.
Luisa Mercedes de Freitas.
For the University of Padua, the IMA Director, Professor Paolo De Stefani.
Marie Stella Bloom. Mona Mir Satari. Julie Volders.
Representing Ca' Foscari University of Venice, the Pro-Rector, Professor Fabrizio Marrella.
Priscilla Di Hentin.
For Adam Mickiewicz, University Poznan Human Rights Center, in representation of the IMA Director, Dr. Agata Hauser.
Andrea Trey.
For the University of Coimbra, the IMA Director, Professor Jonathan Machado.
Alessio Incorvaea.
For Universidade Nova of Lisbon, in a presentation of the IMA Program Director, Professor Helena Pereira de Melo.
Lara Tim.
For the University of Ljubljana, in representation of the IMA Director, Professor Jure Pozgan.
Lucrecia Cineros-Rishon. Iris Posthorn. Andrea Schebach.
Representing the University of the Ust of Bilbao, the IMA chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Noel Cosin. Federica Lombardi.
Therese, please stay on to represent the University of Seville.
Oren McGee. Pineda.
Representing Lund University, the chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Leah Ferrix. Minos Papakiakos Popoulos.
Therese representing also Uppsala University.
Manuela Baker. Nina Fuico. Francesca Mancarella.
For Maastricht University, the IMA director, Professor Andrea Broderick.
Veronica Fastnaver.
For Utrecht University, the IMA director, Professor Antoine Buys.
Livia Cintranello Ferro. Caroline Hansen. Charles Antoine Labouf.
Representing the University of Nottingham, the IMA chairperson, Professor Therese Murphy.
Angela Maredz. Noemi Vanderbroek.
And for Queen's University Belfast, the IMA director and IMA chairperson, Therese Murphy.
Sinead Gall. Congratulations to everybody, and let's have a round of applause for the new graduates of the IMA 2021 year.
And now the awarding of the IMA internships by Professor George Rurik, Global Campus Academic Director, and announcement of the IMA Awarded Thesis 2020-2021 by Professor Therese Murphy, IMA Chairperson.
Distinguished speakers, colleagues, families and friends, and first and foremost the graduate in class, now we can officially call you Masteroni. You're no longer IMA students, but IMA graduates. So once again, warm congratulations to each and every one of you. It's been a very extraordinary and challenging year, and as many speakers have noted, you've risen to it with creativity, resilience, commitment, and maybe some of the spirit of indignation as well that Michael was calling for. So I look forward to staying in touch, working with you, and also welcoming you into the family of IMA and Global Campus alumni. At this moment, we are acknowledging the special achievements of the 15 top graduates. They will be named in no particular order, randomly at the request of the students. You will be offered the possibility of an internship, and you will be contacted tomorrow by Elisabetta Sanero. So as I name you, I would be grateful if you would just briefly stand up so we can acknowledge your particular achievement. Olga Peneva. Mafalda Moreira. Freya Smith. Agnes Henrici. Andrea Scheibach. Caroline Hansen. Petia Mitova. Alessandra Tisi. Rian McCall Magan. Mariana Gonsalves. Katia Stokes. Annalie Boren. Angela Mawid. Charles LeBeuf. Manuela Biker. Congratulations.
Buonasera, Masteroni. A good evening, graduates. Congratulations. For my fellow professors and I, it was a privilege to read your theses and to have the opportunity to engage with you about them during yesterday's defences. Thank you very much. And let me just emphasise that, in case you hadn't recognised it, my fellow professors and I, we span Europe's countries, so we bring considerable expertise to bear. It was a particular privilege for us to read the following theses. These theses achieve a standard of academic excellence. That's no small thing in itself. But they achieve something more that's hard to describe. They somehow catch the eye, or perhaps warm the heart, or most importantly, set the imagination alight. There are six awarded theses, one for the Global Campus and six for EMA. I begin with the Global Campus Award. Supervised by the University of Southern Denmark and the Danish Institute for Human Rights, the title of this thesis is Patent Rights or Patient Rights? An assessment So that was a spectacular failure on my part to read out a title without you realizing who had written it. The author of this thesis, Patent Rights or Patient Rights, an assessment of intellectual property and the right to health within the COVID-19 pandemic, is, as you all recognized, Alessandra Tisi. Congratulations. And now, in no particular order, the five EMA-awarded theses. Supervised by the University of Hamburg in Germany, with the title, Idir Aharu is Akran, the framing of women's agency in Northern Ireland's counter-terrorism legislative discourse during the Troubles. The student author is Rian McCall Magan. Next, supervised by Aristotle University of Thessaloniki in Greece, with the title Refugees' Experiences in Sites of Prolonged Displacement, Liminality and Exception, a case study of the Diavata refugee camp in northern Greece, the student author is Annalie Boren. Next, supervised by the University of Deusto in Spain, with the title From Myanmar to The Hague, a feminist perspective on the search for gender justice by Rohingya women before the International Criminal Court, the student author is Federica Lombardi. Number four, supervised by the Catholic University of Leuven in Belgium, with the title Reimagining Truth and Redress, Racial Injustice Against African Americans in the United States and the Current Push for Transitional Justice. The student author is Katie Boatwright. And the fifth and final of the EMA-awarded theses was supervised by the University of Cyprus with the title, Handle with Care, How to Improve Access to Healthcare for Deaf People in a Pandemic. The student author is Agnes Heinrici. Congratulations. congratulations to one and all. Thank you.
And now the awarding of the IMA Alumni Award 2021, introduced by Adam Jacoby Merler, President of the IMA Alumni Association, and presented by Professor Manfred Novak, Global Campus Secretary General. Artist Koen van Mechelen and Fondazione Berengo generously donate this artwork by Belgian artist Koen van Mechelen to the 2021 Alumni IMA Alumni Award winner. The award is a glass sculpture entitled Collective Memory.
First of all, of course, congratulations on behalf of your community, the IMA Alumni Association. It is no small feat what you have undertaken the last year, and I understand that it has been even tougher than it has been for many of the previous years. Many of us have been there, us in the IMA Alumni Association and the wider community. We know that it's with a sense of excitement, awe, and a drizzle of fear that you will now venture out there into the world and apply your skills. But fear not, because you are not alone. Although it's a big world and the 60 plus of you may feel tiny as you gaze out upon it, out there you're joining a family of like-minded human rights defenders and democracy defenders. Almost 2,000 of us, the alumni from the IMA, more from the Global Campus Regional Master Programs, the partner universities, and many more with power, passion, indignation, and desire, such as we just heard from Jette Nebesch. We need you, we need your thinking, we need your action. You heard it from many of the other speakers. We need you to join the organizations, be the grassroots, join civil society, think, be the change. And we welcome you. We welcome you in the IMA Alumni Association. Come join us, connect with your fellow alumni, and use the network both professionally and, of course, socially. Many before you have sat where you are now sitting, and many of them have met the same doubts. It might seem impossible, but it's when we start to act that we see hope and that we find a way forward. Something can appear impossible, but only until it's done. So we at the IMA Alumni Association, we want to highlight and recognize the incredible work that you can do, and we give a voice to human rights defenders through this. And that's why we in the association are proud to present the IMA Alumni Award. This is the third year that we awarded to an alumni who has and still is making a significant contribution to the advancement of human rights and democracy. One day it might be one of you. It is the artist Koen van Mechelen. I will just read up a short note that he has asked me to read about the award and how it looks. You've all seen it. It's in the monastery. This one, of course, is a bit smaller. It's called All History is Contemporary History. A child looks at the horizon. It is staring into the future it has dreamed of for itself, but its gaze is anchored in the events of the past. A past made up of the myriad facts we believe to be reality, our collective memory. The child is resolute, hopeful, progress is real. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights is fundamental to our collective history. Its records support the child who sits on them. One day it will be able to stand up on them and reach for the sky. The column of books, in this case just one, is not yet complete. This is where you come in. It continues to grow. It represents the building blocks of a political model that even when under fire is the foundation on which all progress stands. Its name is democracy. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights serves as its beacon and guide, the very basis of the intercultural society of the future. Starting with ancient Greece as the cradle of our democracy, the child, all the way to the Encyclopedia of Human Rights, the books. The installation Collective Memory delivers a clear statement. It looks to a future built on our fundamental human rights, which act as a guide to subsequent generations. This installation represents them. Above all, it claims that every newborn child has the right to a life worth living in which there is lasting respect for human rights. Those were the words of Koen van Mechelen. Now to the winner of this year's IMA Alumni Award. He is a graduate from 2011. He's a frontline defender, an activist, and a voice for victims of forced disappearances. He works tirelessly for the victims and survivors of serious human rights violations around the world, and he is one that truly makes a difference. Manfred, the floor is yours.
Yeah, the name of this very well-known Nepalese human rights defender is Ram Bhadari. As Adam said, he was a graduate of 2011. He lost his father in 2001, and his father is disappeared, as so many others in Nepal, during the time of the armed conflict between the monarchy at that time and the Maoists, where tremendous human rights violations occurred. Enforced disappearances, torture, the killing of child soldiers, ethnic minorities, women. And he dedicated his life, on the one hand, to assist the families of disappeared persons to try to find out what happened to them, their fate and whereabouts. And he also involved the international community. He sent numerous communications to the Human Rights Committee of the United Nations. Michael was one of the members of this most important treaty body of the United Nations, to the Working Group on Enforced and Involuntary Disappearances. And I also had the honor to be 8 years a member of that. And at the beginning, we received his communications, but also to the Special Rapporteur on Torture. And it happened to be that it was me at that time. And we got so many communications, allegations of torture, that it made it much easier for me to convince the government of Nepal, which was at that time the country with the highest number of allegations of torture in the world, although it's a small country. And I said, I don't know whether it's true, but we have to investigate. So please invite me for a fact-finding mission. And that's what they did in 2005, and I visited. And I should say, out of 18 official fact-finding missions, there were only two where I found systematic practice of torture. One is Equatorial Guinea, and the other one is Nepal. And it is thanks to many human rights defenders in Nepal, including Ram Bhadari, that we could actually not only investigate, but also together with the Office of the High Commissioner and others, improve tremendously the human rights situation in Nepal. Unfortunately, Ram Bhadari cannot be with us today. Why? Because he didn't get a visa. So he's still in Nepal. That's why I more symbolically handed over this award to Adam. But we will hold our next international conference, and it's a very special conference on child participation, real child participation, because the children will actually decide about what the topic of the conference will be. And we will hold it by the end of January, beginning of February in Kathmandu. And I very much look forward then to hand over this beautiful award for outstanding IMA alumni to Ram Bhadari in Kathmandu. Thank you very much.
Easy, we're not done yet, we're not done. Though Ram did not have the possibility to be here, he does send his thanks to us for this award, and he sent us a short audio clip. I will attempt to play it for you, and we will see how that goes. So here it comes.
Hello everyone, namaste. I'm really humbled to receive this award today. I accept it with greater honor. I joined EMA in 2010 to hide from ongoing threats because of my human rights activism in Nepal, especially as the EMA program opened up a door for me to enter the human rights world, where I acquired a knowledge base to strategize rights advocacy and solidarity in the field to advance my work and open up further networks. I thank my mentors, friends, colleagues, and professors who inspired me to stand for humanity and human dignity. I was the first ever Nepali student enrolled to this wonderful joint degree program. To be a part of EMA community and alumni of graduates made me feel proud of being within the global community of the human rights world. I wish great success to the new students who joined this year and send a solidarity message to all alumni who continually contribute to advance the rights of peoples around the world. My daily work is driven by the motivation to create a just atmosphere and to help others. I am emotionally attached to the rights of people and their struggle for justice. It derives from our own acts that produce the power of love, compassion, and assistance towards other human beings by connecting with their cause, which in turn creates a larger healing power for everyone around us. Let me share my personal story that saved me to get to where I stand today as a voice for victims, an activist, and also an academic. Over the past 2 years of the current pandemic, I have reflected on the years of my own personal pandemic caused by enforced disappearances. Looking back, the journey has been long and hard. It is like a horror movie in my life. 20 years ago, on December 31, 2001, my beloved father was disappeared after being arrested by security forces from the streets of Besisar and taken to the district headquarters of my hometown. He was handcuffed, blindfolded, and heavily tortured. My father was a dreamer, an educator, and a cultural activist, well known in local communities. He was a school teacher for more than 3 decades and worked to transform local communities through education, arts, and culture. My father's dream was kidnapped from him by state-sponsored security forces. He has never been seen again, but his dream is still alive within me. I became involved in the search for my father after he was forcibly disappeared. We do not yet have full accountability. The government's attempt to forget and to provide amnesty to the perpetrators has created new conflicts and tensions in communities. I personally went through the entire process and have achieved nothing in my search for the truth about my father. Gradually, I became engaged in the victim rights movement globally and nationally. I have spent the last 2 decades working for the families of the disappeared. It is a very personal cause for me, and I never imagined how hard the fight would be. But the world has not done enough to acknowledge the suffering of the families or listen to them. We have to tell our stories to the world, reorganize and prepare for a long battle to keep the voices of the families alive. As I continue on my journey, I am optimistic that we will someday find answers and justice. I dream of a world without disappearances. I want to pay tribute to my disappeared father, thousands of other disappeared victims, and respect all the families in their struggles around the world for the long battle for justice, who are the frontline defenders of victim rights and fighting to protect fellow victims and defenders at risk. The work of these victims and survivors, along with that of other activists around the world, is essential for the collective fight to keep the justice agenda alive and to sustain non-violent struggle to secure their rights. Enhance their role in their justice process, entrains respect for human rights for all, and create a solidarity discourse across the world. Often their activism is at risk. I and many other activists in the field face threats, hear of abuses against them, imprisonment, torture, killings, disappearances, sexual abuses, and other inhuman attempts to silence their voices. I will never ever give up the fight for our cause and human dignity. I stand for all rights, civil, political, economic, social, and cultural, as well as for the well-being of all human rights defenders in the field. I also express my solidarity for the well-being of all human rights defenders in the field. I also express my solidarity for all human rights activists and our wider community of IMA alumni fellows across the world who works for protecting human rights, give a voice to the voiceless, making an international shield against injustices, growing inequality and deep-rooted impunity. I'm once again deeply feel honored to receive this award and greatly appreciate the role of the Global Campus of Human Rights in Venice and IMA alumni for your notable efforts to encourage human rights defenders around the world in providing strength and intense dedication to make our work visible, fomenting even more inspiration to become a part of positive social change. Thank you very much.
Now the inauguration of the European Master's Degree in Human Rights and Democratization, academic year 2021-2022, introduced by the rectors and professors of the IMA universities, professors, students, and guests, will read the solemn formula to declare the academic year 2021-22 open, which you find written at the bottom of the ceremony program. Please stand up. Bearing in mind the principles of international law of human rights and in the spirit of inter-university cooperation, we declare open the 25th academic year of the European Master's Degree in Human Rights and Democratization. And now interpreti veneziani will play for us Ode an die Freude of Ludwig van Beethoven. thank you for your participation. The professors will now leave the stage in procession, and you are invited to proceed to the ground floor. Thank you.